and we're trans.
Ladies and gentlemen.
They thems.
Welcome to Locker Room Talk.
And non-binaries across the nation.
Ladies and gentlemen and non-binaries, please. The Michael Buffer is going to have to, the whole thing is just going to be listing all the genders.
It's time to identify yourself on the gender spectrum.
You know, eventually there's going to be ladies, gentlemen, those non-binary, and those that refuse to accept the binary. You know what I mean? That's going to be the next thing, because you got the binary and you got people that are neither men nor women, and then you're going to have people saying there are no men and there are no women.
I'll tell you what, to say you're non-binary
is to even acknowledge the harmful binary itself.
That's why we're going to have the fire start, which is hey y'all. That's going to be the future greeting. That's
just
going to
be hey y'all.
Isn't that
time is money, baby? We
Does y'all include bald women though?
No, not that. All humans.
Newest protected class, bald black women.
Bitches. Look at all the bald Jada Pinkett Smith, Sinead O'Connor, just like these troublemakers.
Krillin.
All of the women in the Holocaust.
Right.
Who else is bald?
That's going to be the whole podcast, naming bald women.
Who's that bald bitch?
The newest game show. Name that bald bitch.
Ba-da-ba-ba-ba-da. I'd like to poll the audience. Who do you think? The audience has no idea who this bald bitch is.
Yeah, dude. There's so many bald bitches out there. I don't know. I think if you have a nice, like, rounded face.
So many bald bitches, so little time.
They're the worst, dude. You can't even, what are you going to grab them by to bring them to your house, you know?
All right, Bobby. We were just having fun.
Well, someone had to say it, and that someone was me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, thanks for the history lesson. thanks for the reminder that consent was a thing that happened 5 years ago.
If you think about it, G.I. Jane is actually the best thing to call a bald woman.
Yo, I watched that movie because of Will Smith. I've never seen that movie before. I watched it. Dude, her, especially when she just like shaves her head like the next scene and she's doing push-ups braless in that white t-shirt and you could see her nips.
Yeah.
I'm like, I'm going to come immediately.
Well, why don't you just watch Striptease? She gets completely naked in that.
I think
she's not bald in that though.
Yeah, even better. She looks like a woman. Man, she looks like a woman.
The best thing about being a woman is that people will write think pieces about you if your husband goes insane.
Yeah, G.I. Jane's the best thing to call a bald woman. That was like, when everyone got upset, I'm like, it's not like you called her a cue ball dipped in coffee.
I know.
Like,
cue ball's the funniest.
Yeah. Sam, you've been sitting on that all week.
He really, well, you could tell, dude. You could tell. That's fine. We love it.
Yeah, okay, that rules. Yeah, dude, the way that she reacted initially pissed me off so much. Just that, oh, well, that simply will not do.
Yeah.
To say that I'm bald and make a timid joke about it, even though being bald is a little bit unusual.
Yeah.
No
it's
way.
It's against human genetics. Women aren't supposed to be baldies.
Yeah.
Maybe men, because like when they're so alpha, they lose their hair, a la Stone Cold Steve Austin.
Yeah, dude.
But a woman. No way, dude.
Yeah, she did kind of look like Stone Cold Steve Austin now that I think about it. That was great. Yeah, so we're recording this in between the two nights of WrestleMania.
I know. Are you going to cancel Fight Club to watch WrestleMania here?
I watched night one yesterday.
I'll watch
some of the replay tomorrow.
We could stay here. We could order pizza. We could make a whole night of it, dude. You make an announcement that Fight Club, family emergencies prevent. Yes. Tried and true fucking ace in the hole.
I think I have in the past canceled Fight Club because it's on Sunday nights for WrestleMania.
Yeah.
But I like did it like a month in advance.
But you can't cancel last minute. Who are you? One of the participants?
Yeah, any other person that's done the show.
What are you? Almost everyone that does it?
Yeah. But I did. It is funny that a week apart, it was the Oscars and the opposite of the Oscars, WrestleMania.
Yeah,
something
prestigious that means something to a lot of people. And the Oscars!
Boom, folks! Professional comedian Joe Gorman.
Hey, we're just throwing out some softballs right now because we all need to heal.
We all need to. This is season for healing, and I'm here for it.
Yes, it is. Dude, it's the season for WrestleMania, and I'm here for it. Who would have thought the fighting would be more real at the Oscars than WrestleMania?
Yeah. There's no right before the slap, you didn't hear Chris Rock go, "Hit me."
Yeah.
Hit me and then go back in your chair and yell like a crazy person.
Yeah. Was there anything more shattering for the image of pro wrestling than the fact that The Rock did nothing during the slap?
The Rock wasn't. Should have come out and interfered with the steel chair.
They should have cut to The Rock, and then everyone started cheering for The Rock for like a long time.
Yeah.
And then Will Smith starts looking like left and right on stage as everyone starts cheering.
Who's gonna come? Whose music is that?
The Rock, he stands up all slow. And he takes off his fucking tuxedo coat.
Yeah.
And everyone's like, that's the best.
Hell
dude.
Yeah, dude.
Make wrestling fun again, man.
Yeah. Logan Paul wrestled.
Mm-hmm. I saw that. And you know what? I liked that Happy Corbin storyline. That guy's funny. He cracks
that
me
was
up.
That was something I was my roommate Mark Henley. He watches even more like week to week.
Yeah.
And I watch like here and there. That Happy Corbin story, if you watch week to week, was so bad so many times. But when you watch the recap, we were both like, actually doesn't seem that bad. If you had to sit through like a 6-minute segment of it every single week for 6 months, you'd be like, I so fucking hate this. But you just see a little recap and it's like, that's kind of fun.
Well, that's the thing, is I feel like so many of those storylines just go on for so fucking long that they could get like 7 or 8 storylines and if they just condensed everything.
Well, they're doing like so many different sketches and bits every single week, and then WrestleMania comes around and you just see like 3 minutes of the last year and you're like, oh, this is pretty good. I'm like, yeah, they showed you the only 3 good minutes of it.
Yeah, there's like it gives you less incentive to watch every week because there's so few matches. It's mostly just more and more storylines.
Yeah, there'll be some matches here and there, but overall, I think it's gotten to the point where the floor, WWE is so big that if 1 million people are going to watch every week, it's not like when I was younger and it's like, I gotta see what this guy's gonna do on Raw this week. That's not really the incentive anymore. There's TV deals, it's a network, they're not trying to sell pay-per-views anymore.
The title doesn't even change during like Raw or SmackDown. Like, they would never do, like, it's always a pay-per-view.
Yeah,
where the title actually is on the line.
Yeah, every once in a while they do, but the whole, like, just financial incentive structure is completely different. But still, like, WrestleMania is still awesome.
Yeah, it's always going to be fun.
Yeah.
That's going to be, like, something everyone
Bobby was over at my apartment watching.
How did you feel, Bobby? It's like a mostly outsider.
Dude, to
pro wrestling.
I was the Jane Goodall of WrestleMania yesterday.
Yeah.
Dude, WrestleMania does roll.
It's fun, huh?
You know, I like went there. I'm like, I'm going to watch this retarded thing because I love my friends. And then I was like, actually, I'm fully emotionally invested in this now.
Especially Becky Lynch versus Bianca Belair.
Oh, that was ay Dios mío, Poppy. That was very good. The girl with the red
hair. That's what you said during the Rey Mysterio match, too.
Yeah. I was a little bummed to hear that Becky's the girl with the red hair, right?
Yes.
I was a little bummed to learn that she was the girlfriend of the icky guy later.
Seth Rollins.
No, she's married to Seth Rollins.
Yeah. Married.
They have a baby.
So like, I have no chance.
Yeah. The icky guy?
To me, he seems icky. I'm sorry.
One-third of the Shield.
Yeah.
Mm. That's funny. So I guess like that was the benefit of all of those recaps on WrestleMania, so people like Bobby can
normies like myself
dive in,
and
still get like good pops from like when they see that, so they know who to root for and who to boo.
Dude, it really is. It is tough guy dancing. That's what I got from watching it. I'm like, these are tough guys, and they're dancing, and it's so cool. You know what I mean? I think I actually, because I've been a firm believer that dancing is gay for a while.
Yeah.
And then I was like, well, this is dancing, and it's tough guy dancing, and I'm like, oh my god, they tricked me into like dancing.
Yeah, you know? That is. I usually don't like when the matches look too much like dancing.
Uh-huh.
I kind of want it to look more like a fight, but I want it to be athletic and fast moving. Also, it does kind of bum me out when you're like, "Oh, they're dancing." I'm like, "No, they were fighting." Fuck.
Yeah,
it's supposed to be fighting.
The part I like the least, and I don't know if I can fully explain why I feel this way, but when they do the punch for punch thing, like Stone Cold Steve. Spoiler alert, everybody! Stone Cold Steve Austin. Well, everyone watches it live,
everyone
I suppose.
Knows.
Yeah. Stone Cold Steve Austin and the Canadian guy, they're like
Owens,
punching each other back and forth. I'm like, I don't need this. You know what I mean? Because I know that they're mad at each other, and I felt like it was foreplay to the acrobatic things.
Yeah,
and Stone Cold's too old to do the acrobatic things. Yeah. Anyway, so
Stone Cold, the reason they did a no holds barred match is because Stone Cold can't like do real wrestling stuff, but he can get hit with a chair. I was surprised he got suplexed on the concrete floor.
He still got it, man.
At one point they like threw him into the wall, and you could see he can't run. So
that was like, it wasn't bad to see that, but like you want to see like him go against The Rock or something one more time.
I liked him versus Kevin Owens in Dallas. It was good, but yeah.
Like, I think he's got one more in
it
him.
Is also so surreal for me. And like Kevin Owens was on a couple of shows I was on back when I wrestled.
Damn.
Like I was in a rec center in Pennsylvania with this guy in 2010, and then he main evented WrestleMania against Stone Cold Steve Austin.
That's pretty
Isn't
cool.
that fucking cool? Like,
that's insane.
The two fields you've been in, you've seen so many people get all these fucking that's gotta
Yeah. There's a couple Ooh. People who've like done Fight Club that now have like hour specials.
Yeah. Yeah,
and now you Since that wrestling guy wasn't like, hey, isn't Trump awful to like fucking standing ovations?
You yeah, know? That's true. The wrestling, Kevin Owens is actually doing something fun.
Yeah.
Yeah. The Fight Owens fight was like for the Capitol riots. His character was like going there to fucking beat up everyone at the Capitol.
Yeah.
Fight Owens fight.
Yes.
He's like killing the police officers and stuff.
Yeah, that's where you guys get out of locker room talk. If you, after this last week, thought, I wonder what they're going to talk about. It's 2 minutes of the Oscar slap and 10 minutes of WrestleMania.
Probably more than that, dude. We're just getting started, man.
I will say, some of the reaction to the slap at the Oscars was the funniest thing
Wild.
All week.
And every time something like this happens, I'm like, I even tweeted, I was like, there's going to be one think piece about how we have to protect black women.
There were more than one.
Yes, there were multiple. I'm like, holy shit, man, this is really I think somebody, I forget who, someone said like this is cancel culture personified.
It's so weird that people are calling it cancel culture. I'm like, when a bad person actually attacks someone and does a bad thing, it's cancel culture.
What I'm saying is like Will Smith literally hitting a comedian for saying something he doesn't like.
Yeah,
that's like cancel culture magnified.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, that
like,
is
literally,
I mean,
shut up. I don't like what you're saying. I'm going to physically attack.
Oh, that part of it. Yeah. There is like, we spent the last 10 years every time a comedian says something we don't like, trying to get them fired, saying they're awful. At what point is somebody not going to think, I should hit them?
Yeah.
It wasn't if you like, say jokes or violence for long enough, someone's going to respond to a joke with violence.
Yeah. Yeah. Will Smith was using self defense.
Yes.
Yeah. It wasn't. It wasn't
Let
like.
Let go of my purse. I don't know you.
It wasn't like the Cat Williams when he got his ass kicked when he was like
with
on
the
like
by the fourth grader or whatever.
When he was like on crystal meth and like got beat up by the fucking, it was like a middle schooler, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, he wasn't on stage presenting an award and doing jokes at a show where you're hired to do jokes.
Yeah, he was just on drugs in public, man.
Yeah.
Living the life.
And some people were saying like, oh, well, that was ad-libbed what Chris Rock said about Jada. I'm like, who cares?
Yeah.
That's makes him fucking funny and in the moment. And he's trying to make everybody have a nice time at this weird award where rich people tell each other they're great and give each other golden statues.
Yeah, and you know Chris Rock is going to have like some lifetime invite back to the Oscars because it's like
that was
security should have like done something.
How did they let him stay there?
It's like, damn, there have been like comedy clubs that have taken better care of comedians than the fucking Oscars, because like nobody gets close to you on stage.
Yeah. They said they asked him to leave and he refused. I'm like, of course he would. Yeah. That's not how you answer.
Yeah,
I'm in security.
I work security.
Yeah. You ask people to leave, they say no. They go, okay, well, thank you for hearing me out. I hope you enjoy your continued stay.
I'm glad that you heard out the fact that I would like you to leave, and I asked you to leave.
Yeah, thank you for listening to me. I feel seen.
Yeah.
Dude, and anybody that watched the Will Smith acceptance speech for the award and didn't immediately pick up narcissist vibes, I don't know what to tell you.
Yeah.
I think you might not know what a narcissist is then.
If you watched that whole acceptance speech by Will Smith and didn't know what a narcissist is,
you might be a narcissist.
Here's your sign. Blue collar comedy's back. All right, let me tell you something. You make fun of no bald bitches get made fun of in blue collar. All right, the only person that gets made fun of in blue collar is our jerk boss. Whether it's a bald bitch or a fucking fat fucking guy, doesn't matter. You might be blue collar if You this ain't afraid to get like him at all.
Get her. Get her done.
Here's your sign. I'm terrified of a black man slapping me. What if it gives me an erection, y'all? I plumb get kicked out of the KKK if they knew these lecherous thoughts of a Negroid gentleman, muscular as God intended, descending upon me on stage and parading me with slaps.
You're a KKK member who doesn't think a man should make fun of a black woman's hair. Here's your sign.
Damn, dude, I love blue-collar comedy, man.
Yeah.
I forgot how fucking great, I forgot how defining that was in my adolescence, the blue-collar tours.
Here's your sign.
Mm. Who? I guess you're like the Bill Engvall.
Engvall?
Engvall.
The Bill Engvall.
I guess you're the Bill Anvil.
The Bill Anvil.
What's his name?
Bill Engvall.
Yeah.
Bill Engvall, yeah. I think he's like the least exciting of all of them. He's just like a less good Jeff Foxworthy.
Kind of, him and Foxworthy were the two headliners, and Ron White and Larry were their openers. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And I think at this point, Larry and Ron White both kind of got bigger than the two of well, at least Jeff Foxworthy kind of stopped doing so.
Oh, listen to the guy who clearly hasn't seen the latest Jeff Foxworthy special.
I did see the latest Jeff Foxworthy special. Yeah,
well,
special.
Then you would know that motherfucker is still a fucking headliner.
Well said.
Thank you.
Awesome. Yeah.
Sometimes you got to passionately defend your opinion.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Like Dr. Gay in the New York Times.
Yeah. Oh, my God.
How funny is that, dude?
I'm Dr. Gay, here to say you don't have to take jokes if you don't want to. A legitimate article in the New York Times written by Dr. Gay about how you shouldn't have to take jokes.
I think we could all agree, especially if her name is Dr. Gay, that jokes are done.
Yeah,
you know why they became a doctor. Mm. You can't be like, sorry, Mrs. Gay.
To try and cure her own homosexuality.
Yeah, maybe you should prescribe yourself a chill pill. Yeah. How about that?
Although calling any angry feminist Mrs. Gay is very funny.
Yeah.
Mrs. Gay, please, it's Dr. Gay. I didn't spend several years in gay school to be called Mrs. Thank you. I went to gay school.
Bobby sent me like excerpt from the article specifically where Dr. Gay says that what's happening in this moment is like a Rorschach test because everyone's just projecting Rorschach test where everyone's just projecting their own experiences onto what happened. I'm like, really? Dr. Gay maybe thinks other people are projecting their experiences onto a subject when she says that jokes are not okay.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. In the next paragraph, she goes after like, oh, this is a Rorschach test for people to get on their soapbox, and it's time to stop making fun of black women. It's like, yeah. Jesus, you like at least let one another paragraph other. Go by. Yeah,
yeah.
Does that was fantastic. The type of people that think the only comedy you could make is where the punchline is capitalism is bad.
Yeah,
that's
capitalism good.
Yeah, we're a pro-capitalist podcast.
Yeah, the funniest people are capitalists.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. We're a pro-capitalist podcast. Once we make a certain amount of money on the Patreon, mm-hmm. we need to have a tier that or like a goal. Mm-hmm. Once we reach $3,000 on the Patreon, we become a pro-capitalist podcast.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
How is it that like we're like, oh, we hate capitalism, but then they're also like, we love hustle culture. Work hard for your money. It's like, well, fuck, which one is it?
Pick one.
Yeah, because if like we don't like capitalism, then we should be in like this kind of socialist society where we all just put in the same amount of work, which should be what the wake up and put in the equal amount of work in which you take out of the same system.
Yeah, why don't we tell Twitter people that communism on social media would mean everybody gets the same amount of likes?
Mm. What about
that they would turn against socialism
what
real
if,
quick?
What if we support communism?
Ooh, all okay, right, there
it's an entire economy based on semen.
Mm-hmm. Ooh.
Okay. Semen is nice. Currency.
Nice. Well, looks well, like once your mom again, is going to be all my the holder of all the capital. Damn. Mm. I'm sorry. That didn't make a lot of sense.
Yeah. Also, yeah, me and Bobby said that if we'll start the Patreon, we'll have a goal for 10. If we have a $10 million tier, mm-hmm. if anyone joins it, we buy a mansion.
That's all we need. We just need one subscriber. Yeah. One person to believe in.
That's such a poor guy thing to do, to buy a mansion and then not know that you have to pay taxes on it next year.
Also, like, what a little
we'll
kid.
Rent a mansion for a year.
Also, what a little kid fantasy. It's like, oh, when I get that money, I'm going to get a mansion mansion, and all of my friends are going to live in it with me. Yeah. We're all going to live in a mansion.
I mean, it's literally what Jake Paul does, and he gets to be on WrestleMania.
Yeah.
Dude, but I'm glad he was the bad guy, because I'm like, we all know he's got a punchable ass face.
Yeah,
right?
Well, so Logan Paul was the wrestling, Paul, but sorry. Jake Paul was on the pre-show. Ooh. And that was actually kind of funny, because Jake Paul is just a real life bad guy. Yeah. Like, that's just like who he is. And the girl who was like interviewing him is almost like doing this role, like she's playing this character who's the fake host of WrestleMania, almost, where she'll like react to things like, oh, well, okay, actually, Rey Mysterio is really tough. Like, she's dealing with a person who's a real life heel trying to be the character of a host, and just almost didn't know how to handle it. Because it's like, oh, this guy's just a real, like, Booker T and Jerry Lawler would chime in every once in a while, and they kind of knew how to handle it. But the host was just kind of like, she's only dealt with other people playing characters and didn't know how to deal with the guy who's a real life lunatic.
This is her first time coming face to face with the Shadow.
That's funny. Booker T was having flashbacks to Chris Benoit. It's like, I need to guide this man's responses so he could kill his wife and child immediately. Tell me he didn't just kill them.
Yeah. A lot of people feel that Chris Benoit was a sucker.
You know what's weird? There's a civil rights activist that's actually named after the wrestler Booker T.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy. Yeah.
Whoa, that's awesome. Matt, did you ever wrestle with Chris Benoit's son?
No.
He did.
Yeah, he did. Chris Benoit did.
His older son. He has an older one.
Yeah, I think he's talked about like wanting to get into wrestling, but he's talked about that like long after I was ever wrestling.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
If anybody wouldn't want to repeatedly get hit in the head, do you think it'd be the surviving son of Chris Benoit?
Maybe.
Yeah.
He looks exactly like Chris Benoit, too.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
And he uses the last name Benoit.
Yeah. Really?
Yeah.
Interesting.
I think that's Chris Benoit's real name, though.
It is.
So it is like his son's real last name.
Yeah. But, I mean, you could change it. You know what I mean?
Like Mr. Perfect's son had a different name than Mr.
Well, WWE like changes their names a lot. Mr. Perfect, Kurt Hennig's son, was wrestling, and he started as like Joe Hennig. Then he got to WWE, and they're like, "Nah, we like Michael McGillicuddy more."
Okay. Okay.
Which is so weird. It's like, why don't you play up that? And then they were trying to get back into that legacy aspect of it. But
they ended up naming him like Curtis Axel.
Right. Because
his dad is Kurt Hennig and his grandfather was Larry the Axe Hennig.
Ah.
But after that, it was like, we've seen this guy as Michael McGillicuddy for 3 years already.
Well, and they McGillicuddy, also, that is not a tough name.
Yeah.
Well, they also tried to make him a Paul Heyman guy, too.
Yeah, they tried some stuff with him. And I thought he was really talented. Apparently, The Rock, worked out with him to train for his return against John Cena.
Oh, dang.
That's, the ultimate compliment. The Rock is like, that's the guy I want to help train me for my comeback.
Mm.
That's got to mean something. He's probably still, involved. They're probably still taken care of him if that's the case.
Yeah. And, there's a few guys who, sometimes Cody Rhodes, they're, son of Dusty Rhodes, Charlotte Flair, son of, Freudian slip, daughter of Ric Flair. Mm-hmm. But then there's another guy, Braun Breaker, who's Rick Steiner's son, and they just don't, I guess Rick Steiner's not as big to them as Dusty Rhodes or Ric Flair.
Mm.
But still would be cool. Last name Steiner is a pretty big name
that's
in wrestling.
That's a big fucking draw still. Yeah. You just got to get on some of the good, it's so funny how they're like, oh, the wellness program is like, they're all on steroids, dude.
I don't know. I think they're, we were talking about it yesterday. My roommate, Mark Kenley, told a story about meeting Balls Mahoney back when he was a teenager in New Jersey. Because Balls Mahoney just lived there. And he was like, they were at a beach or something. I don't remember where they were, but he was just shirtless and he looked all shitty and out of shape. And he was pissed because they drug test him. And he's like, yeah, I can't do steroids anymore. They won't test John Cena or Batista, but they fucking test me all the time.
Damn.
Wow. Just a guy. I wonder if there's those big dudes that are kind of fat and it's straight up they work out and they take steroids, but they also don't think about what they eat for a second.
John Cena is 100% clean though.
Yeah.
You look at him and it's like, that guy is just hustle, loyalty, and respect. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Dude.
Mm-hmm. Peacemaker
That's what
would never.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Peacemaker would never.
Mm-hmm. You better not do steroids, dude. That word barely rhymes with anything.
Oh, yeah, if he's trying to be a rapper still. Mm-hmm. How are you going to rhyme steroids with that? Did you ever see the CNN like hit piece they did on John Cena back in the day?
No.
That was like one of the earlier, formative moments in my not trusting the media when they screwed over John Cena.
Oh, wow.
It is like very silly but it was. I think whenever there's something that you specifically know a lot about and then you see like mainstream news like cover it, you realize how little they know about the things they talk about.
Yes.
They interviewed John Cena and they asked him about if he'd ever done steroids, and WWE released the raw footage after, so you saw the full interview. Mm-hmm. And he says in the raw footage, absolutely not. I've said that my whole career. I've been drug tested my whole career. I was drug tested playing football. But everyone has an opinion, no matter what you say. Anyone's going to think you did it. So it's like, I can't say that I haven't, but no one can ever prove that I had. Mm-hmm. And then on CNN, on the special, the way they played it was, have you ever taken steroids? I can't say that I haven't, fucking but no one will ever be able to prove that I have.
God damn it.
They got his ass.
I bet when he saw that, he was like, Nihama?
Yeah. Yeah. CNN thought that we couldn't see them. But we got the footage.
But it's like, you look at like fucking Vince McMahon, and it's like, all right, come on.
Well, Vince did steroids. He's admitted it.
I've done it. I put that stuff in my ass.
Dude, Pat McAfee is like wrestling at WrestleMania, and he put up on his Instagram, Vince texted him at 3 a.m. from the gym, squatting 1,000 pounds. And then told Pat McAfee, Austin Theory's going to kick your ass. Vince McMahon's 76 years old and squats 1,000 pounds.
That's wild. I personally squat while holding a 30-pound dumbbell.
Mm. I squat to pee.
Nice.
Yeah, I just have like that 25-pound kettlebell that I squat with. Mm-hmm. That's good enough, dude.
Yeah. Yeah.
I've been doing a thousand pounds worth of squats then.
Yeah.
I've been fucking around with the Stairmaster.
Ooh, look at you.
Some people say it there for women, and they're right, but I like it.
Ooh. Yeah, black people call it the Stairmaster.
Black people take the escalator.
Right. For me, anytime I see wrestling covered by any like news source, I realize how little they know. What's like the thing for you? Because you related to me immediately when I said
this
it.
This is going
to
sound super specific and weird, but do you know the podcast Serial?
Yeah.
Oh, is that the like serial killers podcast or crime?
It wasn't about serial as in like series. So it wasn't wasn't about serial killers, but
it was about Kellogg's, General Mills.
Dude, that made me so angry.
A cereal podcast this week, Honey Nut Cheerios.
But it still has like the same dramatic music. Yeah. We just want to milk this for all it's worth.
Yeah.
No, it's about there's this guy, Adnan Syed, and he allegedly, I guess I don't have to say allegedly because he got convicted. He got convicted of killing his high school girlfriend, but there's some people, here to us all, really dispense some justice on that one. But but some people are like, oh, I think he might. And it's one of those things where like, if you really look at it, it looks pretty clear cut, but there's like the making a murderer type thing where there's enough like idiosyncrasies. So
what was his name again, Bobby?
Adnan Syed?
Yeah, guilty.
Yeah, the jury was full of a bunch of Joe Gormans. So
hey. I'm an upstanding citizen, goddammit, and I know. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. That name sounds a little cutty heady offy, if you ask me.
This was the prosecution's defense.
Yeah.
That's what it was. But they there's so not Serial itself, but like of course after like there was this huge podcast about it. You had all of these sort of B-list documentary things that were done, and the one for Amazon Prime was, I think, literally from Adnan Syed's family.
Yeah.
So like, not the most biased ever, right?
Yeah.
But I'm still watching because I watch stuff. I know it's biased, but I'm like, I'll just watch the other side later.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So,
if you want the truth, you watch Tucker Carlson.
Exactly, and hear about what Kid Rock thinks about Kim Jong Un. But at one point they were, so there's an alternative suspect, and they were trying to just paint like how weird he was.
Yeah.
And so the murder took place in February of 99.
Yeah.
And they're like, this guy was always playing the new Eminem album.
Yeah.
And this alternative, so they're doing the violent video game shit basically. Right. They're like, there was this weird guy, he liked the most famous rapper of all time, you know.
So this whatever. Muslim guy's family is trying to paint this other guy as a weird. He is a weird man. He does not pray to Mecca. He doesn't slaughter a goat in the backyard. What can we think of that? Yeah. All right, pal. He puts an American flag in the front yard. It's really weird. They have a dog in it. Like, are you going to eat that thing or what, man? Like, what's going on? I hope we get picked up by Compound Media, dude. I really do.
Yeah. Well,
speaking of which, I'm on Wet Spot next week again.
Nice, yeah. Dude. Tell Chrissy Mayer I said what's up, dude.
Hell yeah, I will.
Get her on the pod. She'll be the first guest on this pod.
First guest we have is Chrissy Mayer.
Yeah.
Real thoroughbred of comedy.
Hey. That may have flown on the other podcast, not here.
Yeah, to here, to that we say nay. Yeah.
Yes.
We respect women here.
Yeah. Anyway, Bobby, so that was like...
Okay, sorry. So, yeah, they were... sorry, yeah. Joe distracted me with his good points about how the Muslims were weird. But so they were like, oh, this alternative suspect, weird guy, listened to that new Eminem album a lot. And the Eminem album came out, I believe, on Valentine's Day... of 99.
Yeah.
And the murder happened beforehand. So it's like that weird guy wasn't listening to the Eminem album before the alleged murder.
Because it hadn't come out yet.
Right.
This guy who does not even worship Allah has some kind of time and space continuum kind of power, and I don't understand it at all, but there's evil, I tell you. You look at him and he's very evil by not killing a goat and letting the dog run around.
See, I don't want to cut him off, but I don't know how long this goes on for.
You don't want to.
Yeah. Don't worry. The monologue's winding down.
It was not my son who killed that woman. It was the real Slim Shady.
I can only do it. It's like the Indian. I hope that sounds close enough to Muslim.
You just do an Indian and hope that our listeners are as racist as we are.
Yeah, I hope I never get any fucking contract with Disney.
You will, to do the voice of their new Indian prince.
Hey, baby girl, why don't you come over to my palace and take your picture of boob and vagine? Hey, baby girl, come on, let's get down to
the boob and vagine thing is so funny. That will never stop being funny.
It will never stop being funny. It will never stop being like a stereotype. It's like we have like the screen caps.
Yeah, yeah.
It's true.
Yeah. Yeah.
We have the evidence. Yeah.
We got the receipts.
See, I think I read something at some point, like the explanation for that is like the end of arranged marriage is just so new still that they literally just, they have no, I mean, there's simps in every country, but in India specifically, they just have no idea. They're like, I don't know. My mom was supposed to do this for me. So I guess, hey, beautiful. Like, they just don't know.
They do not have the game. You got, look, you either have the game
it's
or
an
you
unfuckable don't. Accident. Accent. Yeah. It's an unfuckable accent. For sure.
That's why you got to get the heavy cologne and you got to wear a silk shirt and a big heavy chain that shows off your chest here.
Yeah.
Anyway, cereal.
Yes.
Bobby.
Eminem.
That was basically it. Being like, they're saying he loves this album that he couldn't have listened to till after the murder.
Yeah.
But no one besides someone that's autistic about Eminem knows that. Like, no one pauses the documentary and checks the dates. They're like, okay, I'll buy that. You know?
Well, in general, when like... Yeah, like the John Cena thing is big, but with sports things, like any things you know a lot about, you see like a trusted source cover, and then when they get it such an obvious thing wrong, like they were like giving a list of wrestlers who died young, and one of them, when they were talking about drugs and wrestling, and like one of them was Owen Hart, I'm like, that wasn't because of drugs.
Yeah,
you can't do that.
Yeah,
it was like, drugs, all right, dude.
Yeah,
the drug of money.
Yeah, and then it'll just be like, how can they possibly be getting all the aspects of a war writer if they couldn't look up how Owen Hart died?
Right, yeah.
Damn.
It's a little disheartening because you're like, that's their only job. Like, that's their 9-to-5. It's just like, check everything that you say. And they're like, that's hard. I needed to take a long lunch.
Or things become so like polarized into like, it has to fit the narrative of how I feel about everything else. And then the actual facts of the thing don't matter. Most things there's like gray areas in, but that's not as exciting.
Yeah,
like as a sports fan, the whole Colin Kaepernick thing, the way everyone turned to either he's the he was in a Super Bowl, he's an amazing quarterback, and he should be starting everywhere, or he's terrible and should never be playing on a team, and the reason he's not in the league is only because of that. I'm like, no, he was... He got to a Super Bowl. He kind of flamed out a bit. He still would have been in the league if not for the protest.
Yeah.
But he's not so undeniable that someone has to sign. The truth is just...
Almost nobody can be like, regardless of how I feel about what he did, here's the objective truth about his career. Almost no one can do that.
Yeah.
He was a black guy, and he did something he shouldn't have done.
Yeah. He knelt during the national anthem, which I also did during WrestleMania last night.
I fucking kneel all the time now, baby. I'm all about that shit, dude. Yeah.
To suck penises.
It's fucking cool. Yeah. It's like, damn, this is so much easier.
The worst person to interview. Why are you kneeling? It's fucking awesome, man. You ever stand? It's fucking hard. It's hard on your knees.
It's easier to suck dick that way. Otherwise, I was just lifting a dude up to fucking mouth level, dude.
Yeah, dude.
Yeah. Mm. Cut to Kevin Nealon being like, why's everyone got a problem with Nealon?
Yeah.
Nice, dude.
That's my favorite joke I've ever said on the podcast.
Mm-hmm. I like it.
That's a random call to Kevin Nealon.
May he rest in peace.
Yes. That's a guy who's had like kind of a like such under the radar but solid career.
Yeah.
Been in a lot of Adam Sandler movies. I don't know who this is. You would recognize his face if you saw him. Mm. He's been in a bunch of Adam Sandler movies. He was on SNL. Mm. He's had a couple of hour long stand up things. Probably can still tour and sell out places.
Yeah. He does that subconscious comedian bit thing, you know, I was driving up the highway having an affair, and on the way over there, you know, I decided to, take a stop at the public restroom, gay sex, and it was great.
Just Matt's afternoon plans. That's crazy.
Exactly. I know. Yeah. A classic. Yeah. Back when SNL would hire like actual comedians.
White guys.
Oh, speaking of comedians, did you see that this guy's fucking gay?
Gerard Carmichael, yeah.
Yikes, dude. He stole my bit.
Who is that?
Gerard Carmichael. He's had a few specials.
I watched that show, Carmichael. Do you think that makes me gay now?
Yeah, he's...
Bad in the Sex with Men.
Right.
Oh, no.
I think you'd probably know him if you saw him. I think he's funny.
Most of his podcast is me not knowing famous people.
Yeah.
I can't. I was supposed to feature for him at a club, and I canceled because of that.
Yeah, on his most recent special, he came out as gay, and he's been like in the public eye for at least like close to 10 years, if not more.
How was that audience able to keep that? Did they sign an NDA?
I'm surprised nobody walked up and slapped him in the middle of his set.
Now that is why you slap a man.
Keep men's penises out of your fucking mouth.
We're just goofing. Hey, this is just some locker room talk.
I visited the Newport Mansions this week.
Oh, you're just a little tourist, man.
I really am. I had a day and night off this week, and I think it was like 2 days before I was back home visiting my parents. My dad drove me back home, just driving through the city and Jersey City, and all the traffic and people. I was like, I have a day off this week. I'm getting out of the city. And I went to Rhode Island, just $30 Amtrak.
That's not bad.
Yeah, and I never been there. Newport's got a whole bunch of really cool stuff. It's a small small beach town. 15 minutes to walk from one side to the other, and both sides are surrounded by the Atlantic Ocean.
Did you just stay like by the train area?
The train goes to Providence and Kingston, and then it's like an hour bus from there to Newport.
Oh wow!
So I did the bus to Newport, and then hung out in Newport all day. Got some clam chowder. Did the cliff walk. There's a whole like walk along the Atlantic Ocean, and then there was like a popular spot in the late 1800s for like super wealthy people to build their mansions.
Cool.
So I went through a whole tour of like with the Vanderbilt's mansion. Basically everything you were saying before, like I'm gonna get a mansion for all of my friends and family. And that's what the Vanderbilts did.
Damn. Yeah.
That's what the Patreon's for, to get the Vanderbilt mansion.
Yes.
Damn, dude. And then we just what should we do when we get it? Just fucking
record a podcast there.
That's it.
Maybe stay there a few nights and then sell it and not tell anyone.
Do you think if we ever got a mansion in like a few weeks, we'd want to like be back in a shitty studio apartment?
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? Like those North Korean defectors that end up sleeping on the floor of their fancy Seoul apartment.
Yeah, exactly like that.
No,
yeah.
I can't see myself doing that. I can't see being in a mansion and being like, man, I really miss having a 3-bedroom top floor two-family house in Jersey City.
Yeah, yeah. I would love to. I would definitely get a cleaning lady, though.
Yeah.
That's because I
think you have to in a mansion.
Yeah, I can't.
You can't keep a mansion clean on your own.
Yeah.
Well, even the idea of, like, I have a mansion, but I can't afford to clean. Like, just doing the vacuuming yourself would feel very weird.
Yeah. You get, like, a knockoff Roomba.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, all right. Halfway. Yeah,
I'd like a Joe Mansion.
Mm.
It's just a house you live in while destroying every progressive's dream of America.
Hell yeah, dude. Nice.
Dude.
Also the International Tennis Hall of Fame is in Newport.
How was that?
Did it suck? Because it sounds like it sucks.
I actually did like it a lot.
Okay.
I mean, I've worked security at the U.S. Open. I'm not a huge tennis fan, but like walking through there, I was like, it's kind of weird.
Tennis is a lot like this podcast. It's a lot of back and forth.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah, and there's
love.
There's a lot of love also. But we're both big history people, and when you're going through there and you're seeing like a history that you don't really know anything about, but you can like tie it into things that were happening at the time. It's like just like seeing the story of like this person winning tennis championships in the 1910s, and I'm just like, this was happening when like Taft was president.
Taft, yeah.
And that kind of stuff is fun for me.
Mm.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Nice. Sounds like a racket.
So that was just like a day trip?
Yeah.
There and back?
Just went there for the day and then came back. Mm-hmm. And then was up the next day and just back to normal bullshit in New York City.
Yeah, Matt hates New York.
That's wild, man.
Yeah.
I think if I do more trips like that, I won't hate it as much.
Well, Matt's lived in New York his whole life.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Have you, Bobby?
I have not. I'm an upstate boy. Hudson Valley represent.
I think that's so like for you, it was like something you were working towards.
Yeah. I'm still like having a nice time, but it's been 6 years. Maybe I'll hit a wall eventually.
I've been in New York for 4 years. So maybe not, dude. The city fucking rules.
I think there's like there are good things about the idea that you could just walk outside. If you have a Metro card, look left, look right, you can go anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Or like other places, you'd have to be like an hour drive to get to some place that you can just go to in 20 minutes here.
Yeah, but when you're in your own car driving, you don't have to worry about something pissing on you.
That's true too.
Yeah, but it's so hard to maintain a car in New York City, dude.
Yeah, in New York, no. But, like, if I had a car somewhere else and I could just drive to everything, like, I don't know. I think I would miss some things about the city, which is why, especially with comedy, I like living here as my main place. But then if I can, like, relatively often, like, once a month, even if it's a day trip, just, like, go somewhere else, just spend a night somewhere else, then I think it would make it more bearable.
Yeah, that's what everybody that's not, like, a misfit like us does anyway when they live in New York. Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah, Incel Rising.
Yes.
Damn, dude.
Yeah. No. Yeah, you either go away for a week or you sit at home and watch WrestleMania.
Yeah.
Or spend all of your week on Twitter talking about the Will Smith slap.
Dude, I'm like a bit obsessed with it.
Yeah. Oh, me and you both like, I mean, Joe had some really good tweets too, but I felt like me and you were, I mean, every couple hours I would look and see what you were tweeting because you'd have like three more. Like, me and you just took in, you know, we were just a couple of New York City comedians doing what New York City comedians do.
See, Matt, if you leave New York, you don't get to say that anymore.
That is true.
Yeah, dude. You'd lose everything.
That's what's keeping me here.
To me, it was the easiest thing to tweet about because there's a clear villain. You know what I mean?
Not. That's the crazy thing. Is not really. It seems like every poll that comes out is like half the people think it was okay.
To me, there's it's a clear villain. Like if Joe Biden does something, even if I'm like, that was a dumbass thing to do, I'm like, well, it's politics complicated. There's nothing complicated about what Will Smith did. You know what I mean?
He lost he damn mind.
Yeah.
He out he damn mind.
See, Joe, you got to put this pen to paper and submit it to the New York Times.
That's what I think.
For 400 years, they had that boot on our neck. And for one glorious night, we could have stood on stage in brotherhood. And instead, you raised your fist to your brother because of a Delilah. A bald-headed Delilah. Lord. All right, I'm done.
We were at the Oscars that night. Comedian got up on stage.
See what happens when Billy Crystal does host shit?
Made fun of my bald-ass wife.
But you are right. The polls are like 50-50, which is why. But you know who is more likely out of old people and young people. I read this one poll, 65 and older or younger than 65. Who is more likely to be on Will Smith's side?
Is it younger people?
It's younger people. Because I thought it was going to be like the like kind of frivolous, like older generation, like honor culture type shit.
Yeah.
But no, it's like... the bulk, I think, is the cancel culture crowd, which is crazy to me.
I was saying it earlier. That's weird. The people who are like cancel culture coming after Will Smith trying to ban him from the Oscars. And I'm like, no, cancel culture. I mean, the term is just so overused now. Right, people just use it to mean anything.
Yeah.
But like for most people who use it, I think we're saying it's you're getting comedians or people in trouble for having an opinion you don't like or just making a mistake or something
or
like
a joke you don't like.
Yeah. I mean, putting some like when somebody gets punished for committing a crime, that's not cancel culture. Yeah. And Will Smith actually didn't get punished for the crime.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. He got a damn Oscar.
Like if you assault somebody in front of a crowd, and the worst thing that happens is you're not allowed in that venue anymore, you got off easy.
Yeah, you got away with it, dude.
Like us saying that he should be kicked out of the Oscars is is a lighter punishment than what probably he should get.
Mm. What's the most Oscars somebody's ever won?
Like an individual person, yeah. How many Oscars? I'm not sure. I think like for one movie, like Lord of the Rings won like 14 or something like that. Mm. One person, you mean like in general, there's between like supporting actor and best, maybe like 4 or 5. Yeah.
So he's already ahead of the curve by getting one.
Yeah.
So he could never win another one in his life.
Well, that's actually not true. He left the Oscars voluntarily, like the Academy.
Yeah.
So he can't vote anymore. But that doesn't mean anything about whether or not he could be nominated, win, or attend events.
Wait, so yeah, I didn't really understand what it meant when he said he's leaving the Academy.
So there was like an investigation.
Yeah.
And it's one of those things where he's like, well, why don't I just leave?
Yeah.
Although they could still like sanction him further. So him leaving the Academy means he can't vote for awards himself, but he could be nominated, he could win, and he could go to the ceremony.
Wait, so was he able to vote for the award when he won it?
I don't know if you could vote for a category you're in, but okay. they do. Actors are it's like such a small proportion of who's actually in the Academy that it's inconsequential that they can vote.
Well, that's
it's like
too,
all these industry people.
Are they all in the Academy? Like
I think you can get like an Oscar. You can register to like vote and shit.
I didn't know Will Smith got to vote on who won awards.
I believe that's how it works because they said that's one of the things that not being in the Academy takes away from you is that you can't
vote. I guess
anymore.
Then I didn't know he was in the Academy. Like for the Baseball Hall of Fame, there's like the writers vote and then there's a veterans committee. Mm. I didn't know that like for Hollywood Oscars, like Fresh Prince gets to vote.
It's probably something similar to that where there's there's an industry thing.
And a veterans committee also.
Yeah, I'm sure most of the people that vote are people we've never heard of.
That's what I was thinking, that it would be something more like that. Mm. But yeah, the idea, I didn't know that Will Smith gets to vote on who wins Oscars.
But I think functionally he doesn't win another Oscar because people don't like him and won't vote him. You know what
he
I'm saying?
You never know.
I mean, they gave him a standing ovation. The people in that world may still like him enough.
So as much as I think like they're a bunch of like unprincipled like chicken shits for doing that.
Whoa!
I'm sorry. I just had to go ahead and say it. But
we're
going
to have to bleep that out, Joe.
Yeah, we're going to. Please do. Let me timestamp.
Please,
yikes.
In post, please, guys.
I'm going to make it seem like he said the N-word.
Yeah. I would never do that on mic, but they're like, as much as they're like idiots for doing that and like sycophants or whatever, I think part of the reason they did it was just the awkwardness of not doing it. You know what I'm saying? It's almost like you had the people that didn't clap in that room, and I don't even know who they are. I don't know if they were filmed not clapping.
White guys.
But they're actually brave. You know what I mean? So the people that
not as brave as Amy Schumer.
Not as brave as Amy Schumer. Of course, she's a fat woman. No one's more brave than that.
Damn.
But I think privately when you're like the. You're not going to be scrutinized either way if you're asked who to vote for and you're a performer. Although, I'm about to contradict myself. I think a lot of actors are like, slapping a comedian? I love it. Yeah.
Did you see the way Samuel L. Jackson and Denzel hugged him after he slapped Chris Rock?
Yeah.
They were happy about it.
Yeah. Well, because I think... like, the whole reason there's comedians at the Oscars is because without that levity to make these people seem human, nobody would watch. It's like a show for a bunch of super rich people, pat themselves on the back, sell their industry, sell their next movies, buy $1 million outfits they're only going to wear once. Nobody would watch it if there wasn't a comedian there to make fun of them a little bit, so you realize, okay, yeah, they are all of that, but they're people just like you and I.
They can take a laugh. They don't take themselves so serious.
Yeah, but the problem is they actually do, and they actually aren't people, so they probably actually don't like the fact that comedians make fun of them, even though it makes it a thing that the rest of us can watch and not hate them. I mean, we still hate them, but in general, the public can watch without hating them. So yeah, I think there's a lot of them who are probably okay with the, definitely okay with the fact that he slapped the comedian.
Yeah, and not all of them, of course, you know, like they're not a monolith, but there are, if it's a minority of people that feel that way, it's a significant minority.
Yeah.
You know what I
mean? And there's the, also, I think I just saw a thing like Will Smith had a Netflix movie that was supposed to come out and production was like halted on it.
Thank Christ. You know. Well, his last one was fucking dumb, Bright. You ever see that shit?
That, I didn't see it, but apparently that was like, because it was like, I think that was like the first Netflix exclusive movie.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
So it got, it was like a movie that no one really talks about, but I think everyone saw at the time. But yeah, I don't remember seeing it.
I thought it was gay.
Did you guys watch the full Red Table Talk with the cheating?
No.
I watched. I remember. I watched that one. I don't know if
like
I've seen any others.
Full on narcissist. I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Why?
It's, like, it's creepy because
she never at any point acknowledged that what she did may have been wrong or in any way could have been a thing that didn't understand why he would be upset.
And at one point, Will is literally like welling up, like not crying, but about to. That's where those meme pictures come from. And he calls her affair. She's calling her affair an entanglement. And at one point, he calls the affair an indiscretion. And she corrects him and says, "Well, I don't know if I something to the effect of I don't know if I would call it an indiscretion because I learned a lot about myself during that time."
Yeah,
it's like I get a lot of people cheat. It's unfortunate, but like. Feel sorry about it, Jesus. Yeah.
I think the wrong black person got slapped, if you ask me. Well, Will, come get your damn wife.
Tom Segura said we all know who Will really wanted to slap. I think it was Tom Segura who said that.
Yeah. Yep.
Well, he should have. All of this could have been avoided if he just beat his wife just a little bit. Just a little bit. Fellas, if you're listening and you love your wife, give her a little tap.
Hit your damn wife.
Let your wife know that you love her.
Now that Women's History Month is over.
Time for the Epcot of Dude.
Women's I love History you, honey. Month. I would never hurt you. April Fools.
Love makes you do crazy things.
Exactly. That's fucking literal abuser shit. It's like, I actually did it because I care about my wife. But
OJ released a Twitter video saying how he's like, "You can't do that. I know how it feels. I know. I get the feeling. Yeah, yeah. I understand. A lot of people said I was a murderer. I wanted to hit them."
He's awesome, dude.
Yeah.
Will Smith, you have to control your anger.
OJ,
stop with the violent outbursts. Yours truly, OJ Simpson.
Also like a huge Will Smith fan, probably like more than most in that I watch
you
Bad Boys.
You love getting jiggy with it.
Yeah, I do. My parents really don't understand. I watched Bad Boys for Life in theaters. Bad Boys 2 was like my favorite movie for a very long time. It's still one of my favorite movies. I remember because it was rated R and you had to buy the tickets to another a PG-13 movie to get in. I still remember to see Bad Boys 2. I bought tickets to Seabiscuit.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Movie by the way, once again, I'm going to be on Wet Spot with Chrissy Mayer next week. I love Fresh
really
Prince.
Pulling the reins on that one.
Yeah. Fresh Prince, like everything Will Smith, to the point where even after the entanglement stuff, all this stuff, his kids kind of being everywhere, I was still like, I don't care. Will Smith's still awesome. But now after the slapping a comedian because he told a joke you liked and then saw your wife didn't like and then did something.
Some people are saying like, and I think probably what almost definitely happened is he saw her not laugh and like was like, oh, I gotta do something earlier about this later.
Yeah.
But some people do think that he was just sort of like took a second to register what Chris Rock said. I think especially when you know the camera's on you,
yeah,
to like do like, I'm sure he's going like, I'm about to win an Oscar, I'm about to win an Oscar, and then just kind of, I mean, we have all sat through open mics and wanted everybody in the room to like
wanted
us
to get
we
up,
up
and slap the person yeah, yeah. who was speaking.
but I could see him like pretend laughing and not really.
Maybe, I don't know. I feel like, because I mean, you see,
it could go either way. Is what
when
I'm
a
saying.
Guy and a girl, when a couple's together and the guy's laughing and the girl's isn't,
yeah.
I feel like that's what makes him get up and slap Chris Rock.
Yeah.
Is the fact that he laughed and she saw him laugh.
Yeah, yeah,
he
yeah.
needs to make up for that fact to let her know yeah. he actually really did have a problem with it.
Oh my God. It's like, dude, you're rich, you're handsome. Leave this bald woman.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, that's the thing is, having seen, even like there's a clip going around of him, Will Smith, on the Arsenio Hall show back in the day making yeah. bald jokes about a guy in the band
yeah.
and the crowd kind of groaning and he going, oh, come on, it's a joke. I think he was a cool kid who got like fucked up by Hollywood.
I think so. Yeah, just the way he talks about, even like in his apology on Instagram, said, I ruined what was otherwise supposed to be a gorgeous night. Yeah. I was like, why are you talking like this?
Well, that was probably a publicist statement.
I think it's a Jada Pinkett Smith statement.
Yeah.
She's like a weirdo that talks like that.
Yeah, yeah. That's true, too.
Women
yeah.
ruin cool dudes.
They dude, I mean, Will Smith is a cool dude.
Bobby,
Will,
are you going to break up with your girlfriend because of this?
Well, she actually, so I was, funny enough, I was on stage.
Yeah.
I was on stage telling racist jokes against Asian comedian Misha Han.
Good.
When during Comedy Fight Club, one of the judges yeah. told us that Chris Rock got slapped by Will Smith.
And I didn't know the full context, but to hear later that it was because of a joke, I'm like, that does feel kind of jarring that I was up there telling way worse jokes.
Yeah, like at the time when it happened.
Yeah.
Well, the idea is that you all consented to have jokes told about you.
Yeah.
And Jada Pinkett.
Well, she's a public figure, though.
And also, yeah. you're at when you go to the Oscars, there's comedian presenters and everything. Like, you are consenting to have light jabs towards you. Like, yeah, the G.I. Jane joke. It was a light jab. Yeah.
What if Joan Rivers had said that?
Oh, Jada Pinkett Smith is here.
Yeah.
Yeah. Joan said some vicious shit.
Yeah. Wildly vicious shit. Mm. She probably would have had a problem with that whole, like, fucking child sex trafficking thing.
Mm.
God rest her soul.
But, yeah, so afterwards, I was talking to my girlfriend about it, and we've had this conversation before, but she was basically like, never defend my honor. She does. There's two types of women.
Yeah.
I just do Chris Rock's bit, but it's about women and bitches.
Yeah.
But yeah, there's just I was like, what would happen if someone told a joke about you that she didn't like? You'd be like, I don't know. I guess I'd maybe tell the person privately that I didn't like the joke, but in all actuality, I would probably just accept that sometimes people hurt my feelings.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, I mean, we've had the actual thing.
She does have hair, though.
She does have hair. I will say that much. Well, she saw like an interaction on the subway where basically a crazy homeless man told a man and a woman, he was like yelling at the couple, and he said to the guy, "Fuck you and your fat girlfriend."
Nice.
And so she was like, "This happened. I saw it happen." By the way, I mean, my girlfriend's not fat, but she's like, if something similar happens, the plan is that we walk off the subway without you saying anything. So we actually have a contingency plan.
And then you later go on a podcast and tell all of your listeners that I'm not fat.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. But you know what I mean? But like, I feel like there's no world where Jada Pinkett Smith has that conversation with Will, because she's not that secure with herself.
Yeah.
Like, just I mean, it's all in her face when Chris Rock made the joke that fucking attitude of, oh, well, that simply will just not do.
Also, the
like,
whole
fuck off, it's a joke,
whole,
you idiot.
I mean, the next week has been nonstop jokes about her alopecia.
Yeah, yeah. All because of that. Yeah. It was like the Barbra Streisand effect, where you try to make something not a big deal,
right,
and by doing that, you've made it a far bigger deal than it needed to be in the first place.
What did Barbra Streisand do that with?
Barbra Streisand was paying, was trying to pay a lot of money to basically not have these photos of her gigantic, lavish mansion released. Mm-hmm. And by doing that, like, it gained more awareness to how big her fucking mansion was.
Really?
Yeah.
Whereas is that a well-known enough thing that you could just say the Barbara Streisand thing?
No, I had no idea.
Yeah. It was just like a thing on, like, I think TV Tropes or something.
Oh, okay.
But, I mean, yeah. I do recognize her as being another humorless woman.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah. Well, in the end, it's basically like the idea of By trying to go out of your way to hide. It's like if a dude like was bald and he wore like a bad toupee.
Mm. Yeah.
It's like you've just made it worse just by drawing. You've drawn more attention to it.
Yeah.
By trying to not have attention drawn to it.
Do you what percentage of women do you think feel that their honor has to be protected versus
100%, dude.
I think there was like a poll that was like 56% of women were okay with it. So it was like more women being okay with it. Tiffany Haddish, who's a comic.
That's wild.
Honestly, that's I legitimately like when it comes down to like being attacked over saying jokes, if you're a comedian and you're okay with it, I've 100% lost respect for any comedian who's not on Chris Rock's side.
Yeah, I've told you once that female comedians are an entirely different species.
Well, she wanted them all
to know if they want Matt Maron's respect. I know how important it is to them. They need to defend Chris Rock.
What did she say? He stood up for
Jada.
Yeah, and I'm like, dude, I would love to have had someone stand up for the audience of your New York City show then.
No, yeah. Well, here's the thing. It's like, I think Tiffany Haddish...
The joke is I wish someone slapped her while she was bombing. I just have to make that immediately clear. Yeah.
I think the thing is Tiffany Haddish has to like answer to the black woman population.
Mm. She really doesn't, though. Wanda Sykes...
Well, but Wanda Sykes has a trump card where she's gay. Mm, so okay. She has that going for her, too. So
she's higher always, on the intersectional scale.
And like she was also probably like an outcast for black women for being gay. Mm-hmm. You know, how the traditional black people hate fucking gay people. And the idea, that's why Tiffany Haddish was like, it's good to see traditional chivalry.
Yeah.
Wink and nod, I fucking... You know,
hate gay people.
Yeah, exactly. You know. It is, so it is. I mean, that's not for me to say. I'm just a fucking white guy who's not abreast of fucking anything, dude. I'm just chilling. Mm. But that's my observation.
You're Joe fucking Gorman.
I'm Joe fucking Gorman. If there's anyone that understands the fucking mind patterns of a black woman, it's me. All right? I know what's going through her mind.
The Gormaniacs.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But damn, I'd love it if fucking Will Smith tried something on me, dude.
Yeah?
Yeah, I'd fucking suck his fucking cock. turn a fucking enemy into a friend.
What if Chris Rock turned around and bent over?
my props to him, though. As Will Smith was walking up, he goes, "Oh no, Richard."
Yeah.
Like, you're going to call him the name of the character he's nominated for?
I think you heard a TV edit. I don't think he called him a Richard.
No, he. No, he did. He was still. He was still saying like in like the fun mode because he thought it was going to be a bit. Mm-hmm. And even like hands behind his back leans in.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, what are we doing here?
Yeah, he thought Will was going to like hug him or whisper something in
or
his ear.
Or playfully hit him.
Fake, yeah, do the like the fucking wrestling thing you've done on me before, which is
the
like.
Fake hits.
Yeah, yeah. And I think, weren't people saying like until Will Smith started yelling that everyone was like, oh, this is not a bit. Like, that's why people laughed during the slap.
Yeah.
And after Rock said, Will Smith just slapped the shit out of me.
Yeah.
They're like, this has to be a bit because there's no way this is real.
Yeah. Even Chris Rock was probably thinking, did that really just happen? Is that real? Is he going to go back and then laugh about it?
Yeah.
Like, that's why he probably doesn't attack him back in the moment is because he's like, kind of like, this has got to be a joke.
Yeah. It was almost he hit me too hard. He meant to playfully hit me and he hit me too hard.
Yeah. Because he even says, like, it was a G.I. Jane joke. He's like, even he knows it's a 30-year-old joke that's not that good.
He was probably thinking, like, what joke can I say that would be acceptable to get away with on television?
And by the way, anybody online saying it's a hacky joke, you don't know what riffing is. You don't know what talking with your friends in a fun way is. You think every joke is a pre-written thing about how Trump is a bad
president.
I mean,
no one listening to this podcast clearly has a problem with hacky jokes.
Yeah.
I think jokes are that they're hacky are most dishonorable.
Yeah. Dude, I'm getting
also
heated.
If telling a hacky joke is qualifies enough to get slapped.
Right.
How many fucking comedians calling it a hacky joke have to get slapped for every hacky joke they've told?
Yeah, the G.I. Jane joke is hacky, and by the way, all of my punchlines end with, okay, Karen.
Yeah.
Fuck, man. Damn, I hate New York, too. Let's go on the first plane to Texas.
All right, let's do it.
Yeah.
Next stop, Pussyland, Texas.
Pussyland.
If you're listening from Pussyland, please write us good places to eat good barbecue.
Yeah, where's the best burger place in Pussyland, Texas?
Mm. Mm.
Are we really leaving New York?
Nah, dude, I hashtag love New York.
Yeah.
I got to be completely honest with you. But I'm
you put
I'm
the
with-
hashtag between the I and love New York. I hashtag love New York. It's hashtag I love New York.
No, you
dude, Bobby always puts it in there. He has the weirdest verbal dyslexia.
I think I legitimately have dyslexia, dude.
But only
I can't
verbally,
write for shit
dude.
Either.
I hashtag have dyslexia. Yeah.
I have dyslexia and ADHD.
I hashtag am gay.
Yeah.
Oh, man. I'm so shy and nervous.
Do you think people are happy that we talked about the Will Smith, Chris Rock thing?
They're probably relieved. They probably feel like they can probably put a fucking close this dark chapter of American history.
They finally processed it. Do you think there'll be a statue like a generation from now when the moral panic's over and we realize that comedians are the pillars of society? There'll be a statue of Chris Rock bravely taking the slap.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, the same way it's like Jesus like fucking dying on the cross.
It'll be like the Alamo.
Yeah. Remember the Will Smith bitch slap.
Remember
dude,
the Oscars.
I can't wait for comedians to make that a movement of like, yeah, bravely stand on stage no matter what. Mm. No matter what you say on stage, stand there and take your hit.
Well, that's the thing is that also as comedians, we all like we're going to stand up for the comedian. But the second it becomes the second anybody says, yeah, you can't do that. Comedians are really important in society.
We
all immediately are like, shut the fuck
Whitney
up.
Cummings, stop tweeting.
Yeah.
Stop it.
It sucks that comedians are divided on this because like, look at this, dude. George Floyd murdered the entire black community fucking together. Mm. Chris Rock assaulted. Community's like, I don't know. How is like a fentanyl addicted fucking murderer fucking more beloved in the community than fucking Chris Rock?
It is wild to see comedians both sides in this one.
Yeah.
It's insane.
The Candace Owens of comedy.
Yeah, yeah.
Let me tell you something. If you're trying to fucking look at both sides of the situation, I'll cut your fucking throat. Mm-hmm. All right? Mm-hmm. Not a bit anymore. Bit's over.
I will say, last night...
It's murder. It's murder time.
It's always good to end your joke about violence with, I am not joking.
This ain't no joke.
We're reading
the deposition. We can't name every episode just joking.
Yeah. No, I was quite specific. I'm sure
it's just some locker room talk.
Yeah.
Just some harmless locker room talk.
I will say, last night during the National Anthem at WrestleMania, I took a knee to show that I'm an ally.
Nice.
And then couldn't make it the whole song because my knee was hurting. And I think we all ought to appreciate what it took for Derek Chauvin to do that for 9 minutes. Actually pretty difficult.
I don't appreciate... You're making fun of a man that died of a fentanyl overdose.
Right. Yeah, that's true.
Come on.
I shouldn't do that.
Derek Chauvin's still alive, thank God.
Mm,
he
keeping
is.
Keeping us safe.
Yeah.
Keeping us safe.
Wait, is he still a cop?
I'm not sure.
He's a private investigator.
He's
now.
Not, right?
No, and he's in prison.
Oh, he is in prison. Oh, yeah,
Derek
he was
Chauvin.
Sent to prison. I'm sorry. Wishful thinking.
Innocent.
You mean that innocent man?
I could even understand you forgetting that he was convicted, but thinking that he's still on the force is very, very funny.
All right, well, George Zimmerman's out there still keeping us safe on neighborhood watch, at least.
Yeah.
Patrolling the streets.
Yes.
That's crazy, man. Do you think we can get them on the show?
George Zimmerman?
We've actually had this exact conversation on mic before.
Oh, cool. Well, I think it's going
to
happen.
It's something
then.
We keep coming back to. Getting.
I think it's
Zimmerman
eventually
going to
happen. Our 100th episode, we have George
more,
Zimmerman.
We've talked more about our first guest being George Zimmerman than any other person in the world.
And I don't think it's appropriate to have a Hispanic on as a guest.
Yeah, probably not.
Yeah, come on.
I feel like he's an honorary white guy at this point.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Him and the president of the Proud Boys or whatever.
Oh, God, yeah.
Yeah, oh, yeah, that's a Hispanic guy, right?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. I forgot the Proud Boys were still a thing.
Mm, yeah. The Proud Ninos.
That's cool, man. Well, good for them. Surviving, thriving, adapting. They even were mentioned in the fucking presidential debate.
Yeah, they made it. We need to get locker room talk has already been mentioned by a president.
Oh, yeah, that's true. Do you think
we got to make a super cut audio of like just a little locker room talk. Just like everyone saying locker room talk.
Yeah.
making it sound like we're fucking sweeping the nation.
Yeah, dude.
It's all over the news.
That the people talking about that Trump Billy Bush like recording where there were people who were like, "Oh, this is just how men talk." I'm like, I don't know. That was pretty creepy. To be like, I'm famous, so I get to grab a woman by, and I came at her like a bitch. Like I'm like the, a retard that talks about how, yeah, I love big titties, but I would never say I came at her like a bitch.
The,
what does that even mean?
You can grab.
Sounds like he's not a native English speaker.
No, he sounds like a guy who can like get what he wants, but he doesn't know how to talk about it in a cool way. But he's rich, so people just let him say. No one says grab him by the pussy.
Yeah,
but dudes would say things like, dude, when you're rich, women will let you just fuck them or do whatever you want to. Like
But I came at her like a bitch. It's like that does. It makes it sound like you're an Eastern European that like is wearing expensive sunglasses and trying to impress everybody at the college.
He's like he's the like rich dude in real estate who's like hung out with the construction workers and is trying to talk like they do.
Mm, yeah.
It's like when Mitt Romney said, "Who let the dogs out?" when he was taking a picture with black people.
Oh, hell yeah, dude.
Yikes.
Dude, that's like Trump does that with construction workers. Like, he's right. It is just a little locker room talk, but he's bad at it.
Damn, dude. That's back when Republican racism was just, like, silly.
Yeah, it's not the fun locker room talk where it's, like, gay men jerking each other off. It's the bad locker room talk where it's old men with droopy balls just walking around naked.
Yeah, the locker room talk I'm used to is, please don't tell anyone about this, but it's the only way I could come.
Yeah.
Mm. Now get on your knees.
We're talking about some YMCA locker room talk.
It was just some YMCA locker room talk.
Yeah, it's just a little YMCA locker room talk where everyone's gay.
Damn, dude.
Jerking each other off. Talking about communism.
Mm-hmm.
Communism.
Communism.
The equal distribution of semen.
Yes.
All right, what are the dates? What do we have to plug?
Well, this is definitely going to be released
tonight.
So if you're listening to this, make sure you listen to this tonight.
Mm, good plug.
Perfect.
Yeah, a little.
We
plug
never plugged anything
there
on the podcast. Now I'm looking it up. We actually, since we have two comedy fight clubs this week, we have the one in New York next Sunday, and Friday night. If you are in Connecticut, we are doing comedy fight club in Connecticut for the first time ever.
Ooh, what?
Okay. Yes,
Kniff from Connecticut.
I'm trying to look up to
automated
see exactly where
piece
it
of
is.
Shit. You want to melt in my mouth and not in your hands? Melt my ass, you little cock boy.
In West Hartford, Connecticut. I have the address here, but I don't know the name of the venue. Look up on Comedy... Oh, the Elbow Room.
Ooh.
Look up on the Comedy Fight Club Instagram for details. Yeah, Elbow Room. Comedy Fight Club.
Are you
going
to take a train or are you going to drive?
I think we're going to drive.
Oh, that's not bad.
Yeah.
Okay. Just a couple of traveling comedians
doing what traveling comedians do. Be gay.
All right. We'll see you next week. Fuck faces.
Except for Tyrannus.
What power?
Yeah, we're just going to do a quick little sound check, make sure the numbers are...
making sure our voices are sufficiently gay.
Is your mic on?
It's up.
Damn, dude. Okay.
Yeah, dude, I just got to be a little louder.
There you go, yeah.
I really got to assert myself and start to learn to take up space.
We got to just...
Make that space and make it my own.
Yeah.
You have to let people know that it's not okay to make fun of you and your alopecia.
No, you know what? I've been balding since I was 16, and I'm sick of... I want a man... A black man to take my honor into his hands.
Mm.
This is the season for getting black men to hit other black men for you, and I'm here for it.
Yes.
This black. How cool is it? People were saying like, "Hey, there's not enough diversity at the Oscars." You know, Oscars so white, and then surprise, surprise, we get some diversity.
Yeah.
Black and what happens?
Black on black violence.
The two silverbacks in Hollywood try to establish dominance. Hey, folks, welcome back to Eugenics Talk. I'm Professor Arian Gorman, and we're back at it, man.
Mm. Yeah, I'm the Emperor of Japan.
All right,
whatever his name is.
Oh, Ching Chong Chu.
Ching Chong Chu.
Actually, no, it would be like Mi Hong To. No, that's like Japanese, like Hayuto.
Yeah.
Hayuto.
Mi
Hayato Sotodo.
It's Chinese, but with your lips almost pressed.
All right, well, this is definitely on the cutting room floor. This is definitely some paywall content here. I'm going to save this one as paywall. All right, just let's listen back.
Yeah, and once again, I'm gay. Yo. We're back from the sound check, although this is sound check number two, I suppose.
I think this is sound check dose. This is just to make sure everything is in its place.
Sucked one little cock, and my mom got scared and said, "You're moving with your auntie and not your uncle for sure."
So people are saying Will Smith might be gay as shit. What is your stance on this as a gay man, Matt?
Yeah, is he one of you? One of
as a
you?
Gay as a gay man, I was very turned on by the slap. So.
Yeah, he got his. Hey, I'm going to make fun of that bald bitch next.
Yeah, there's a bunch of guys going out there. He's like, "Hey, Will, I think your wife looks like G.I. Jane, too."
For those listening, Matt just stuck out his chin in an effort to get it slapped. Turn around. Will.